Yeah, hi and welcome back everyone. I hope you had a nice first lecture day. Remember when I mentioned that snow is awesome? If you look outside, there's a whole lot of new snow outside. But anyway, so today I'm going to talk about the supervised learning workflow in a little bit more detail. Last lecture day I talked about machine learning and the three categories of machine learning. Now I want to provide some more details about the supervised learning workflow, and then I will also cover some of the necessary notation and jargon regarding machine learning that we will be needing for the remainder of this course. So just laying some groundwork, how we define a training set and what mathematical symbols we use and some terms that we will be using. However, I'm trying to keep things a little bit short this time because, as you've seen in the previous lecture day, there are lots of topics I want to cover this semester, so I don't want to go into too much technical details that are not very interesting for each topic. So I try to keep things a bit short, and then with that I hope we will be able to tackle all the projects that we or topics that I have in mind for this course. So with that, without wasting too much more time, let me get started with the supervised learning workflow. Alright, now let me talk a little bit more about the supervised learning workflow. And we will be using supervised learning a lot in the next couple of weeks. So just to briefly outline how supervised learning works. So supervised learning is, like you remember from the previous videos, the process of regression or classification. So there are essentially two steps. One is the training step, so we train a machine learning model, and the second step is the inference step. But before we get to the inference step, let me talk about the training step first. So imagine you have a training data set, and your task is, in this case, let's say classification. You want to classify something. Let's maybe pick a simple example of classifying different flowers. So let's say you have different flowers, and there might be different flower species. Maybe some flowers are more like this and so forth, and you are interested in classifying how or what type of flower it is based on an image. So you collected multiple flower images, that's your training data set, and you also have an expert, you consulted an expert to provide you with the labels. So it could be, for example, let's say this is an iris flower, this is a rose, and the third one would be, let's say, a sunflower or something like that. So you have these labels, these are your labels that you want to predict, and the flowers, the pictures of the flowers, these are your observations. So you collected maybe thousands of those, this is your training data set, and in traditional machine learning what you would do is you would extract some features. So usually traditional machine learning algorithms don't work very well on image data, so you would extract some features, and here again you would need a domain expert, and having someone's opinion, like what could be a good feature. You can think about it, but also usually it's good to consult an expert who knows a lot about flowers, and it also helps like understanding the data set a little bit. So one might think, what could be a potential feature? It could be maybe the color of the flower, and maybe the height of the flower, and other aspects. The number of leaves and so forth. So there might be different features. You have to think about what could be a good feature, and also what would be a feature that you can obtain from, let's say, the image data easily. So if you have that, if you have these features and also the labels, you can then train an algorithm, a machine learning algorithm, to make predictions. So after training the model, so in this step, so we say training, we can also say fitting the model or parameterizing the model. It depends on what model we are talking about. Some models are non-parametric models, so we don't really update weight parameters in the model, so in that case parameterizing would be not a good fit. These terms,
training, fitting, and parameterizing are kind of synonymous in the context of the deep learning. Now, let's say we have our model. That is our model that was learned from the data or parameterized based on the training data set. Then the goal is to make predictions on new flowers, because the whole goal about developing the model is to use it in some prediction tasks. So for example, if let's say you have a website, you have developed a website where people can upload pictures of flowers, and then your pipeline can predict what type of flower it is. So you would have new flowers, new images. There would be a feature extraction step for these flowers. So here the feature extraction step is exactly the same as during training, because your model has learned to work with this data that it has seen during training. So you have to have the same feature extraction steps here. Then you have your model, and then you can use it to predict new labels. And this is nowadays called inference, as shown here. So inference, why inference? It's a little bit different from statistical inference. It just happens to be called inference, but it's really like you can think of it as prediction on new data or something like that. All right, so this is the typical supervised learning workflow: training a model and then using it. However, somewhere in this process we also want to evaluate how good our model is before we employ it in the real world. So how do we evaluate the performance of a model? So this is relatively similar to the inference step I've shown you in the previous slide. However, we use a test set for that. So the test set here, it looks like the training set, but it is usually independent from the training set. So if you have a large data set, so let's say you have a large data set, what you usually do is you shuffle the data set and then randomly divide it into a large portion for training, let's say 70%, and a smaller portion for testing, let's say 30%. Usually there's a third split. Let me write this down. So this is training, but this is also only an approximate number. 30% for testing. You can maybe also, it depends really on the data set size, we will talk more about that, but you can also just make this a little bit smaller, let's say 20%, and then make this maybe, I don't know, let's say, let's keep it at 70%, and then there could be a third data set here, that's 10%, and that is the validation set that we use for tuning a model. But we will talk more about that later when we also see our first code examples. So for now, consider this test set. And this test set looks very similar to the training set. We have observations and labels. And now what we do though is, so we have this step here, which is like the inference step I showed you in the previous slide. So what's going on here is the same as I have here on the right side, the inference step. It's the same step. But what we do now is we have these known labels. So we separate from the test set observations and labels. We keep them separately. So we use our labels here. We withhold them from the model because there is no training right now. And then we use the observations we treat them as new observations. We pretend they are new, so we pretend these are new labels. Then we do our feature extraction step, give the data to the model, and the model makes the predictions. So we have now two sets of labels. One are the known labels, we know them because we had them in the test set. They are sometimes also called ground truth data. So that is also sometimes called ground truth data, and we compare these known labels to the predicted labels, and then we can count the number of times how often our model makes a correct prediction, and then we can, for example, compute the accuracy. If we count the number of correct predictions over the number of total data points in the test set, that gives us the accuracy. And similarly, we can compute the error by 1 minus the accuracy. So it's like the basic workflow of a supervised learning model. Regarding the data, regarding the flowers, so I also wanted to briefly discuss the difference between structured and unstructured data. So students who have taken statistics 451, the introduction to machine learning, in this class we mainly worked with structured data. So in this class we won't be working with structured data except for some basic examples. So a structured data set is, you can think of it as a tabular data set, or a data set that, that looks like a table essentially. And this is something where you have the data set organized as follows, where the columns are your features and the rows are your observations. So let me go back a step. So this is a table you may get during this feature extraction step. So this is something a human has to do, or you can also automate it in certain points. But imagine the original data would look like an image. So the original data is the flower. So you can observe it either in the real world, or you can take a picture of the flower. And then as a human, you can use a ruler and then make the measurements about these petal and sepal leaves. So sepal and petal are these leaves here. And then you can measure how long they are and how wide they are. So here I have a table of the sepal length, sepal width, and petal width. From an image would be a little bit hard because it's not three-dimensional, but let's say an observation in the real world. So this could be then your tabular data set here. These would be your four features. So you have four features here. On the right-hand side, this is the label that we want to predict. I included it here in the same table. This would be an example of a structured data set. In contrast, an unstructured data set would be the raw data. For example, this image here. So this would be an unstructured data set. So let me write this down, unstructured. Sometimes we also just call it the raw data. So you can actually extract this structured data set from the unstructured data set, but it's not always very simple, because for example sometimes you can automate it. Here it might be hard to automate it. You have to have some human helping with that, like maybe even taking the flower, taking a ruler and making measurements. Structured data is something where we use traditional machine learning, and unstructured data is something where we can use deep learning, because deep learning has internally a feature extraction step. It's implicitly doing feature extraction for us. The downside is, of course, we need much more data. For example, here, this iris dataset only has 150 flower examples, and this is sufficient for regular machine learning algorithms. For traditional machine learning algorithms, such as random forests, you can easily get something like a 99% accuracy with a random forest on this data set. If you want to get 99% performance with deep learning on a flower species prediction task, you would at least, I would say, there are some papers I can maybe link later, but I would say at least 10,000 images of these flowers to get, let's say, within the 90% accuracy. So this is a three class prediction problem. So it would be requiring much more data, and not in every scenario you have such a large data set. So I'm currently also working on a collaboration where we analyze videos, so we classify different videos, and one limitation is that we only have 1,000 videos. So the videos are actually from YouTube, but the problem is the labels. The labels is here what's kind of costly, because you would have to have a human looking at these videos to provide the labels. So it's not always possible to find people to watch long videos to provide these annotations, it would be very intensive. So sometimes you have to make the trade-off, okay, I can use deep learning, but I need a large data set. So if you have a lot of labels available, then it's feasible. But sometimes you don't, and then using a structured data set is maybe not a bad idea, because it's simpler in a sense. Okay, so here's a nice also summary I found in this book. It's a nice cartoon illustrating the difference between the structured and unstructured workflow, where you have traditional machine learning versus deep learning. So here on the left-hand side, this is the workflow for deep learning, essentially, where you have the data and then you throw it into the network. It's like a black box. And then the output is some prediction. So if you get the reference here, 42, if you know the joke, maybe post in Piazza. It's actually, I'm just curious how many people nowadays know what the number 42 refers to. It's kind of a insider joke. Anyways, so and on the right hand side, this is the traditional workflow where you have a human extracting the feature from the data. So you have these handcrafted features that you then provide to the machine learning system and then do the prediction. So it's essentially highlighting the difference between the unstructured and structured workflow or data sets. So the structured data would be this one here in the center, where you have the handcrafted features. Yeah, just to overlay it with the example I've just shown you with the flowers. So on the left-hand side, for the deep learning context, you would just give the model the raw images, and the model will figure out what features to use. So it will learn certain feature extractors. We will talk more about this when we talk about convolutional neural networks later. They would implicitly learn how to extract features. And in contrast, the machine learning workflow with handcrafted features here on the right hand side, where you have these handcrafted features such as taking these measurements here. All right, so that's just a brief overview of the supervised learning workflow and how machine learning is different from deep learning. Next, I want to introduce some of the necessary notation and jargon, and then I will also show you a little bit what type of tools we are using in this class.